Okay, so just for my own benefit, so I kind of know who in the room would classify themselves predominantly as a Java developer? Just kind of raise your hand. Who would classify yourself as, this might be .NET? No, we've got a couple issues. Which is funny because the majority of the events I speak at are more .NET events, and so I get the opposite response. What about JavaScript? Like, who's a JavaScript developer?
TypeScript,
okay. I will touch on TypeScript just a little bit. Okay. Because the interesting thing about that is that we are getting to the point where no matter what type of developer you are, you're going to have to use JavaScript, right? I mean, it's just, it's a no-win situation, we have to do it. So this is just a talk about some things that you should be doing, because you're coming from a different world. So you're coming from a Java world, predominantly, and so it's things to pay attention to. I am from this area. More specifically, I'm right here, like almost in the middle, not quite, but pretty close to the middle. So that was a little bit of a trek to get here. But this conference so far has been fantastic. Like, if you've never been to a conference outside DevOps Morocco, I've been to a few. This conference is great. Like, you can tell the organizers put a lot of energy and passion into it. So be proud of Morocco, because this has been an absolutely fantastic event. So far, we're not even half over yet, unless you can't work out. How many of you feel this way? So this, I was speaking at a conference somewhere, I don't remember where, and one of the vendors had this banner. And the reason why they had, so they're giving away something, it doesn't even matter, but how many of you feel like whenever you're in your Java world, you know, things are going great, then you go over and now you have to write JavaScripts, and you just feel gross. I'm going to use that word a lot now because Jeff hates it when I say the word gross. So, because it doesn't feel right. So, what I want to do in this talk is figure out a way how to get us out of this mindset a little bit, and maybe not look forward to the times that you have to spend in JavaScript, but at least do a little bit better with your JavaScript thing. Okay, just a little bit about me. This is me. I'm John Mills. That's my name. I'm a consultant at a company called Pace Technologies back there in the middle of the United States. I, unlike most of you, am exclusively a JavaScript developer. I only write JavaScript. I do Node.js on the back end. I do React right now on the front end. I've done Angular, a new Angular. I've done Angular Vue.js. I've done many, many different things. I in the past have been a Java developer. I've been a .NET developer. I've been a Ruby developer. I've been many different things. I currently choose to do JavaScript. I'm also a Pluralsight author. Anybody heard of Pluralsight? Okay, a few. I've got a couple of courses out there on JavaScript. They said a couple, I think I've done. On JavaScript and various things. Renzi also has some stuff out there. He didn't say it out loud during his keynote. Okay. So Aristotle has this quote. I like to start with this because this sums up how our attitude should be. So we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence is not an attitude, but a habit. So excellence is something that we build over time by actually trying to do it. Most of the time, when we write code again, how many of you have heard of a small website called Stackbook? Right, small little site, almost nobody uses it. Typically what we do is when we can't figure something out, we type a search in, and we don't even have to go to, I don't ever think I've typed Stack Overflow in my address bar. I search for something, it takes me to Stack Overflow automatically, like Google just knows the AI thing, right? And then we read it, and the checkmarked answer is never the right answer, right? Never, not one time has been the right answer. Go to the second answer, typically that's a little bit the better. And we just go, we take whatever they said, we just do it, and we move on. 2 months later, we have the same problem. We type the same thing into Google, we go to the same question, like, oh, I remember this now. So what I want to talk about is how we kind of get out of this Stack Overflow loop and stop being searchers and start building ourselves up into, just know how to figure out how to do it. Okay, so repeatedly do. All right, the first thing, the way this talk works is I'm just gonna walk through a series of things that we should pay attention to and things that we should do, right? So the first one is to know your code. And here's why I say this. JavaScript is typically not your primary language, right? We've already established this. Most of you are Java developers. You are not really a JavaScript developer, right? It's not your primary language. JavaScript is different. We have the class keyword now. It's not a class. So, like, what JavaScript is doing is very different than what happens in Java or .NET or Ruby or all of these other languages. And we have to keep that in mind. JavaScript, the reason why JavaScript becomes very painful from time to time is because JavaScript is helpful. And it may not seem that way when you're writing it, but JavaScript is helpful. And when I say that, don't forget your summer column at the end. Because, let me ask you a question. How many of you believe, by show of hands, that semicolons are required in JavaScript? Who says they're required? I have all. 4. How many say they're optional? What if I told you, well, I'm not even gonna tell you, hold on. Let me show you something. So JavaScript is a standard. So there's the ECMA 262 standard. And the ECMA 262 standard states this. Certain ECMAScript statements, and I omitted the irrelevant part, must, this is a very strong word, must be terminated with semicolons. So who says semicolons are required in JavaScript? They are, absolutely no question required. However, for convenience, you can omit them. So if you've ever been confused by JavaScript in any way, this is in 2 slides what's wrong with everything about JavaScript, right? So for convenience, semicolons may be omitted from the source text. These situations are described by saying the semicolons are automatically inserted. So automatic semicolon insertion, ASI, is a term that we use to say, hey, semicolons aren't really required. The reason why this is important, I'm going to show you a couple of things that kind of get you into the mindset that JavaScript is in. So the first one being this. I have some code. It doesn't matter what it is. Don't worry about what gets put out. How many semicolons are going to be inserted into this? This is an easy one. I mean, there's no trickery here whatsoever. I'll just tell you so that you feel comfortable in 4. You have 4 semicolons. And the way this works is the compiler, we do have a compiler in JavaScript, starts at the beginning, goes to the end of the line. When it goes to the new line, it says, hey, I have a 2. Does a V make sense next to a 2? And if a V does not make sense next to a 2, it sticks a semicolon. Same thing here. I get to a 3, I get down to an I. That doesn't make sense. I'm going to stick a semicolon. So it's going to stick semicolons in, like that. The reason why we talk about this is because some people don't like to do semicolons. And they choose not to. And then they write something like this. Don't do this. Just first of all. This is bad. Don't do that. But if I did, how many semicolons are going to be inserted into this code? So who says I get one here? Yeah, so I get one here. Do I get one here? Yeah, do I get one here? No. Here's why. Here's what happens. Notice that something. It gets to the end. The compiler goes to the next line and says an opening bracket. Does an opening bracket make sense next to an end? Absolutely it does. This whole thing falls down. because it doesn't put us on. Now you don't write code like this, so this isn't a dumb example, right? Just to prove a point. How many of you have seen these iffy functions? Iffy functions happen a lot, especially if you're doing AngularJS, like the old, I hate to say old because more people use that than the new stuff, but AngularJS, you wrap everything in an iffy, and then you concatenate all your files together, and now you have lots of stuff like this. Does an opening bracket go next to an A? Absolutely it does. So you don't get a summary. So the reality is 99% of the time, it doesn't bother. Every once in a while, it does, because JavaScript doesn't actually put something more perfect. All right, so that's just an example of the craziness that can happen. How many of you have actually seen, so sometimes you'll see this syntax right here. That's why. Because basically, they're going to assume no semicolon was put here. So they're just going to stick one there. All right. Here's the opposite problem. So, okay, Java. I'm not as much a Java developer. Is this more normal, the curly brace on the next line, than Java? Nobody's committing.
Yeah,
I saw one or two head nods. Normally, so in a room of that, I think in Java it's more vague. In .NET, like, it's hard. This is a hard and fast rule. You're curly. So when I click from this to this, like, the whole room is an audible sigh where everybody now feels comfortable with this. But here's the problem with this. How many semicolons are inserted? Can you find any place in this code where a semicolon will be inserted? The return. Why?
No.
Not return. Like down here? Oh, okay. I see what you're saying. It's returning an object. Could put the one there, yes. It actually puts one there. And that's weird. I don't like that, but it does. So if you put your, because, so there's a few things, return, break, continue, are things that are called restricted productions. And what a restricted production basically means is if there's nothing at the end of the line, it stops. So if you say return here, it could actually mean you just want to return. Right? It's a JavaScript node. So it just does what it thinks is best. So my philosophy in general for semicolons is I use a semicolon, and I use linters to remind me, and we'll talk about linting in a minute, that I need semicolons. And then stuff like this doesn't make it. Okay, let's talk about equality for a minute. So are x and y the same? X is what? One. Y is what? One, but not the same one. What's going to print out in this case? Right? Okay, here's why. So remember when I said JavaScript was helpful? JavaScript just wants to help you. But the reason for that is you write code, 9 times out of 10, unless you're writing server-side code, you write code and then you fling that code halfway around the world and then expect it to run. And so there's this JavaScript compiler sitting on the other side of the world that just has to make your stuff work. And it's like, I'm going to try my best to make your code work because I can't send you back an error, right? I can't send the error back to you. I'm over halfway around the world. So what it does, I like to think of it as kind of your roommate or your assistant. You know, you say, hey, this thing needs to be done, and it just tries to figure it out. Like, it'll, you know, send out, hey, do the dishes, and it goes and does the dishes. Anyway, so what it does is it says, is x equal to y? And when x, it says, hey, x is a number, y is a string, that doesn't even make sense. So you obviously didn't mean to do that because you're smart. So it tries to fix it for you. It just fixes the problem. So it converts y to it converts x to a string at this point, actually. And then it says equal. What about false and zero? Are those the same or not the same? Yeah, I'll still get equal. Because in JavaScript, we don't really have, if doesn't evaluate true and false. It evaluates truthy and falsy. So falsy is anything that's false-like. And I say that in air quotes, Because despite the fact that this is actually a value, like a valid value, it's still false. An empty string is still false. Undefined is still false, right? So you get people. The way we get around that in JavaScript is the triple equals, right? So how many of you have seen the triple equals? I'm sure you have. I take that back, actually. I'm not sure you have, because most people don't use it. So triple equals basically means don't coerce your type. That's the term that we use. So type coercion. Don't make this a number. Don't make this a Boolean, just leave them the same. And so immediately, if you're a different type, it doesn't work. So triple equals. This is, even though I do it, I do this, I give this talk, I've given this talk many times, I do this, and I still say this is an example of what we would call lazy programming. And why I say that is, person.name, in this case, is John. So, if person.name, I write whether it exists, I'm just checking to see whether or not this thing exists. And so, if person.name, this thing exists. Great. Does person.dateofbirth exist? Yes. No question. Does person.single exist? No. It doesn't, even though it does. Right? So how do we do this? How do we test for if statements? Or not if statements. How do we test for things? One way, and there's several ways, but one way is you have to explicitly say, hey, is person.name when defined? This is hard. So we do this. I just know. You can test this length in some cases. Yep. There's all kinds of different little ways we can make it work. Okay, so that's it for this part. I'm going to go and do more practical things. But it gets worse, right? Like we have hoisting, we have function expressions, we have prototypes. Things are different. And I'm not going to talk about any of that stuff because I want to talk about other things that matter. But JavaScript is fundamentally different. So here's what I want you to do. Next time you run Stack Overflow, and you see an answer that's not the checkmark answer, it's the second answer, and you don't really understand why it works, but it works, take 10 minutes and see if you can figure it out. I mean, you can have the answer there, that's fine, because it'll take a lot longer than 10 minutes if you don't have, but take that answer and spend 10 minutes just playing around a little bit and figure out why in the world this thing works when whatever it was I was doing before didn't work. You do that enough, and you start to level up pretty far. Linting. How many of you lint your code? Not enough of you. Okay. I should have asked this question earlier. Anybody opposed to hand raising? Okay, nobody. That's good. I was just checking, just in case people weren't going to raise their hand. Anyway, sorry, that was dumb. I now feel bad for myself for asking that. Okay, so what linting is static code analysis. So yes, we have a JavaScript compiler. The problem with the JavaScript compiler is it executes halfway around the world from where I'm at, right? In Java, I can compile my code. I can see if I've got problems. JavaScript, they don't have that luxury. So what linting does is it's going to look at my code and say, hey, here's some problems you may have. Let me give you some examples. The first one, some examples of the linters. So JS Lint, Doug Crockford. Anybody heard the name Doug Crockford before? So Doug Crockford was not, he was early on in the JavaScript process. He wrote the book JavaScript, the Good Parts. He's done many, many other things. He wrote a linter called JSLint, and you run JSLint against your code, and it tells you all your problems. The problem with JSLint was that was the way Doug Crockford wanted you to write your code. And if you've been writing JavaScript for any length of time, you will know that there is never more than one, there's never only one way to do something. And if you constrain the JavaScript developer to only one way of doing something, they will become very angry with you. So we'll talk about IDEs in a minute to prove that point. So they created, off of JSLint, a new thing called JSHint. So JSHint is the one I'm going to show you here in just a second. JSHint is configurable. You can change some rules. You can move things around. It's great. But it's not quite great enough, because it wasn't granular enough. So we wrote another one called ESLint. ESLint is very configurable. You can do lots of stuff with ESLint. And it's very complicated to get it working and set up the way you want it to do. So now they've come all the way back around full circle to standard JS, which is no configuration whatsoever. Don't use standard JS, because their first rule is no semicolons ever. And you know how I feel about semicolons, so I like to leave them off. But so let me show you, I'm gonna demo for you real quick what linting does behind me. Okay, I like that. Let's see here. Where's my mouse? Okay, right here, you should be able to see a whole bunch of things that are broken. Right? So first of all, I've got a return signal with no semicolon. That should be easy, right? I've got no semicolon there, I've got my double equals here, and if I go in, I didn't mirror. Okay, in my JSHint file, notice I said, hey, I need equal to be true. So when I run this, just know, when I run this, nope. Oh, I lose my mouse, that's beautiful. Okay. Hold on. I'm gonna get the mouse back. There we go. Okay. So the way we run this is from the green line, I type JS, no. JS hint. Hot.js. Okay, notice. Let me make it smaller so you can see. Look at that. Right there. Line 5, line breaking error at return. So it's something that tells me right away, hey, you can't do this. Don't do this. This is bad. Right? And it'll tell me I'm missing semicolons, or the best one being. Anyway, it should say equals, but I haven't configured it, so it's fine. So I can go through and I can start to fix these. I can fix this. I can back up, I can save, I can rerun this. And now a lot of those first ones are gone. It's right there in my command. Now that's cool, and it's very helpful, but it's still kind of, I don't know, it feels like almost play. It's not serious yet. I'm just dropping you into. This is a much more complicated app that has lots of stuff. So here I'm pulling in a bunch of stuff. I'm doing things down here. There's a lot going on. How many of you have ever forgot npm install, the npm install stuff, right? And I come into my package.json file, and I comment out, and I get rid of Morgan. And I save that, and I come back over here. I have a linter running in my IDE, and I'll show you how to do that in a second. My linter now says, hey, look, Morgan should be in your project's dependencies. You're using this thing that's not there. So your linting not only checks for the silly double equals, triple equals, although I say silly, but fundamentally important, it also can do much more complicated things. Like, hey, your dependencies are out of whack. you're missing dependencies here, or things are broken. So linting as a whole is a fundamentally important thing. All right. Here. All right, so have an automated system checker code for you. If you are not currently using a linter, I highly recommend JS lint. Pull it down, JS int, pull it down, and play with it a little bit. And configure it and mess around and see what you got. Have an automated system checker code for you. All right. Let's talk about JavaScript IDEs for just a second. Because remember when I said JavaScript developers don't like one way of doing it? I have to have 15 different options, period. Who in the room uses, who just uses, let's say, WebStorm? Anybody use WebStorm? Okay. And a lot of people like WebStorm because it's very IDE, it's very hefty, it feels more like a backend IDE. Right, like Visual Studio or Eclipse or something. Who uses like something lighter, like Sublime? Okay, got a few. Anybody use VS Code? Yep, VS Code is fantastic. Have I missed any?
NetBeans,
okay. Yep. Okay, any more? Any other ones out there? Brackets. Yes, Brackets, I was my favorite for a long time. Now I have converted to Visual Studio Code, but Brackets is very solid. Atom is another one. You're seeing a theme here, right? We have many. Yep, so you can use Eclipse. Notepad, Ramsey says Notepad. I'm going to take a guess in the room, with the exception of this person right here, that I don't have any Vim people. I do not. Sometimes, you ruined my joke. Okay, because typically I will have a Vim person or two, and when I say, did I miss any, they will yell very loud like they're angry at me for ignoring Vim. Because my general rule is not an IDE, guys. Fair. My general rule is the way you know that somebody uses Vim is they will tell you. Like, it'll come up very early in the conversation with you. Hi, my name's John. Hi, I use Vim. Like, normally that's where it comes. Okay, sorry, we went this way. So the thought here is pick a tool. I don't care which IDE you use. It doesn't matter to me. It's not relevant. Pick one that works for you. But then spend some time. So I have three children. I spend, and this sounds sad when I say it, but it's not really. I spend more time with my IDE than I do with my kids. Right? I mean, if you think about it, it's true. Because I spend 8 hours a day in my IDE, and I maybe, even if I spend 5 hours a day with my kids, which is huge amount. We can argue whether I should. But then I still spend more time with my IDE. I don't know IDE nearly as well as I know my kids, right? And you should. Maybe I take that back. But let me show you a couple of things. So in Visual Studio Code, there's some cool things that go on in this IDE that you just should know, and you should be able to play around with it. Most IDEs have plugins, right? Play around with plugins. I've got a plugin in mind called AngularJS, Angular V5 TypeScript. I can come in here. Anybody do Angular development in the room? There's a lot of boilerplate. A lot of boilerplate in Angular. I can write here, a-component, boom, all my components have been done. Stuff. Although if you're doing, I show this, but if you're doing like the new Angular 5 stuff, you should be using CLI. You're not using CLI generally. You're wasting time. Right. Okay. Remember how I was running my JS Hint stuff down here at the bottom? I shouldn't be. I've got a JS Hint right here that I'll enable. I disabled because I didn't want you to cheat. See, now I have a JSN plugin in Visual Studio. Now I get all my JSN stuff. It underlines everything, which is worse. And then you can do silly things. Okay, let me ask you guys a question. This is my first time speaking in this part of the world. I've been to Northern Europe before. I haven't been to Africa before, so this is my first time. I always like to ask questions because really what it seems like is, from a code perspective, we really all still kind of do things the same, which has been great. Who likes tabs versus spaces? Like, does anybody do spaces or does everybody do tabs? That's a horrible question for me to ask, right? I feel like people will fight over tabs versus spaces. But I don't have to worry about it because right down here at the bottom, this is at the bottom, and I'm sorry. Down at the bottom, I can click this little button and say, hey, I'm going to end up using two spaces. I'm going to format my document, and now everything is a two-space indentation. And then I go to another client site, and I'm like, we use tabs. I can just say, okay, that's fine, I'm going to end up using tabs. Or, format my document, boom, I'm out by some tabs, right? I mean, things just work, because I know, I understand my IDE, I understand how to use it, I understand how to do weird, crazy things with it. Like here, I've got var, command function F2, now I'm editing everything. Because we don't use var anymore, and I'm not going to tell you why, I'll tell you why later. And I can just edit everything. Okay, so my point here, I'm not going to spend time on it, although I just did, because there's so many different options, right? Spend some time. So if you haven't done this, when you get back to work, take whatever IDE it is that you use and just look up hotkeys or plugins for, or whatever, your IDE, if you haven't already, and just spend some time playing around. If you have only ever used one IDE, download something else and play around with it for just a little bit. See if you like it. And if you don't like it, and if you don't like Visual Studio Code, cool, it's not gonna hurt my feelings, right? Use something else. But there's so many different options, you just find the one that works for you. Okay, so make your IDE work for you. Strict mode. So, okay, I asked Angular, who's using like Angular, the 2.4.5? Anybody, Angular 2.4.5, I've got several. Anybody using Angular 1, like 1.5, 1.6? Okay. Strict mode. Remember when I said JavaScript's like your roommate, like they're just trying to help you? Don't let it do that for you. And that's the general rule. JavaScript wants to help you out, just say no. That's the right answer. So what strict mode does is kind of help us with this. I'll give you an example. Let's talk about loads. Okay, so I've got some code up here. I've got a thing called to print, and we're just going to ignore that. I've got a function called print that creates a string to print thing that basically just says printing and whatever you pass in. The mechanics now are irrelevant. My question to you is down here at the bottom, I have this console.log. I'm console.logging this string right here. What's it going to print out? Somebody just yell out to you. What's it going to print? Is it going to print printing hello? No. What's it going to print? Who says undefined? Okay. That's a great guess. And I don't want you to feel bad if you said undefined, because that's what most people said. But it actually will print a reference error. It actually literally will print out a reference error. Here's why. So the compiler goes through, and everywhere they see a var, or a const, or a let, ish. That one's more complicated. It creates memory space. Right? And so when it creates this memory space, then it says, hey, do I have a reference for this LHS reference on the left-hand side of the equals? Do I have a reference for this? If that memory space exists, It says yes, and prints it out. If it says no, then I'll get a reference error. And in this case, var is in this function scope. It's not in the global scope. So there is no such thing as string to print. So it won't print it out. It actually gives you a reference error. Now, what if I do this? What did I do? I just removed the var. Yeah, it pops up to the global scope. Because here's what happens. It asks the compiler at the runtime, hey, do I have an LHS reference? Do I have a left-hand side thing for string to print? And it says no when I'm trying to assign to it. It says no, I don't have one. So it pops up to the global scope. And in the global scope, it says, hey, do you have a reference to the string to print thing? And the global scope says no. But he obviously meant to create. Because obviously you wouldn't reference something if you didn't mean to create it, right? So it just creates it for you. Because it's easy, it's convenient, it just generates it, and now you're good. The problem with that is we end up leaking all this stuff up the global scope that we don't mean to. What strict mode does, if I say use strict up here, what strict mode will do is say, hey, don't do that. Don't help me anymore. Give me my reference error right here where it belongs, and just let things blow up. How many of you use the delete keyword? Okay, there is a delete keyword in JavaScript. I have an object, A and B. I actually have found some really good uses for this. So I have an object with A and B. What the delete keyword does is delete something off an object. That's its whole purpose in life. Delete object.a should remove A from my object. See, now it says B to mine. What if I just delete the object? Now, what did I say the purpose of delete was? It removes a property from an object. It doesn't delete an object. What's it going to print? B200. The object still exists. Here's the problem with this. I think this does something. And it did nothing. It just didn't do anything. What if I just delete this variable right here? It's not going to do it. Because JavaScript sees delete something, that thing isn't deletable, and it just says, okay, and moves on with it. That's not helpful, right? If I do use strict, if I put use strict up here, I get to this delete my var, and it blows up. Delete an unqualified identifier strict. You're seeing a theme here. Strict mode makes JavaScript give you the errors. JavaScript likes to swallow errors for you, but doesn't want you to get your errors because you're busy and you have other things to worry about. JavaScript is going to make you get them. This is my favorite question in JavaScript. So the this keyword is a complicated thing in JavaScript, right? Some of you will say it's not, and you may or may not be lying, but let's talk about this. Var object A, greeting hello. So I have a property on object A called greeting. Say hi is a function on this object. How is it, you guys potentially know the answer to this, and that'd be great, just yell it out. How does function get access to greeting? It uses the this keyword, right? So document.write, this.greeting. And it says, hey, this function, this object, has a greeting property, use that. So if I create at the bottom object A.sayHi, and I execute it with John, I'm gonna get hello, and then whatever I pass it. Because this references the current object, right? So what if I created another object called object B? All the object B is here in the back, is it basically just has greeting, but instead of hello, it's something, because in the States anyway, we have what's up, but like it's shortened, they just go, and they do it better. It's weird, I'm not proud. But I already have a say hi function. I don't need to write the same function again. What if I just copy object A's say hi function over to object B? That seems convenient. That's all I'm doing. I'm just copying it over. And then I do object B.sayHi, which greeting is going to be printed out? Because this function was created inside object F. Right? But it's being executed as part of object B. Which one do I get? Hello, John, or sup, John? I get sup, John. Why? The answer is this references whatever is on the left side of the dot. There are more, I'm not gonna worry about the rest right now, I know. But whatever is on the left side of the dot when you execute a function is what this is. If I do a dot bind or a dot call, I can get around that. But for the vast majority of the time, whatever is here, object B dot, is what my this is. Here's where this becomes problematic. What if I just copy over the function to just a variable? I'm not attached to an object at all. I'm just copying it over to a variable. What happens when I execute say hi? What is this reference in that situation? Undefined. Does it? Now, this dot, or object A, this dot greeting will be undefined, correct. This doesn't exist because they don't have anything on the left side of the dot, so it becomes the global. So what happens is here, I'm actually referencing the window or the process, or depending on how you're running this. And some I have walked into client sites and seen them writing and reading from global, thinking they were writing and reading from a local object. Because they had copied things over and they were doing things weird. Now, why is this important? This is important for one reason. Because we actually do this a lot. Because when you, hold on, back up. Use strict, back in the context of use strict. If you stick use strict up here, it doesn't let you go to global. So it'll actually blow up. You'll get a reference error now. So you know that things are broken. So you stick the use strict up at the top, you're done. Okay, this becomes a problem, or this becomes meaningful when we do callbacks. Because when this callback function is executed, what's on the left side of the dot? Nothing. You no longer have your this reference. So that becomes a problem that we have to work around. You can work around it now with arrow functions. I'm not necessarily going to talk about that in depth. Okay, make JavaScript give you your errors. Okay. Know what your functions are. I kind of breeze through this because I am horribly low on time. How many of you see code like this? Christmas tree code. This is gross. No one ever says, all these functions have to be anonymous. I can write this exact same thing like this. I just have a bunch of functions and I call it down at the bottom and it's done. Do that, right? Name your function. Promises. How many of you use promises? You should be. Although in today's world now, I'll point you to another talk, you'll want to use other stuff in addition to that. But promises, now I get this. Async method dot then dot then dot then. So much. So look up promises. Okay. I am not going to talk about this right now. ES6 and beyond, because now we're no longer ES6, we're ES. It was ECMAScript 2015 and nobody liked that, so they just called it ES6, but now we've got 2017, 2018, so on and so forth. If you are, you should be using arrow functions. You should be using constant length. You should be using all of these other things. There is a talk tomorrow given by somebody, Jeff, That's JavaScript Futures. Jazz Futures is that what it's called? He's going to spend 50 minutes digging into all the newer stuff in JavaScript that you should be paying attention to. Don't reinvent the wheel. I've got two left. Don't reinvent the wheel. There are things out there. Lodash. Yeah, I found this much more prominent in the Java realm where you guys are used to pulling down J, everything. Because I've used many of those tools. Anybody use Lodash in the room? Lodash is awesome. It's just a collection of functions that are already written that you shouldn't have to write. You just use Lodash. Bootstrap. It's great. Angular Material. Moment. How many of you deal with times ever and know how horrible times are? Right? We use Moment. We just don't deal with it. We let other people do it. Use packages that are available to us. But not too much. So I'm going to end just for fun with this example. Anybody know what this is? So there was a package called Webpack. Oh, but Jeff's going to talk about it too. That basically its whole purpose in life was to pad the left side of something. That's all it did. And it went up, and like 3/4 of the internet used this thing. And for reasons that I'm not going to get into, they pulled it out of NPM, and was NPM is now fixed. Because everybody was relying on something that was, like, this was the only thing that mattered. So, don't do that. So use packages as much as you can, and don't reinvent the wheel. Right? If there's something out there, NPM something, go ahead and use it. Okay, so I'm going to close with this, because 50 minutes went by really fast. Spend some time figuring out what you're doing. You can always, always, always get better. Even if you know this stuff, guess what? There's more stuff because I can do like 8 hours of it. Every time you're on Stack Overflow, because I know you will be, we all are, spend twice as much time implementing the answers you should so that you can take some time and figure it out. A lot of times the answer on Stack Overflow is going to be, you should be using this package. Great. Don't just go NPM install it and do exactly what they said. Go NPM install it and play around with them a little bit and see. Anyway, I've got to end because I don't want to mess up the next person. But if you have questions, let me know. We can chat. Otherwise, thank you guys for putting up with me for 50 minutes. I'll finish this.